In the rugged mountains of southwest Pakistan lies its largest province of Balochistan. Far from the bustling cities of Lahore and Karachi, this region has been the battleground for a 60-year-long insurgency by the Baloch ethnic minority. Al Jazeera's Islamabad bureau chief, Ahmed Zaidan, is heading into the heart of that insurgency. It's been a 7-hour drive, which started from the provincial capital of Quetta. It has taken months of sensitive negotiations to get here. Finally, Al Jazeera gets to meet the Baloch fighters. It's a first. They have never agreed to be filmed before. As some prepare breakfast, others prepare to receive their leader. The firing of an RPG announces his arrival. And the leader is escorted to meet Zaidan. Given the secretive nature of their base, the fighters are wary of allowing cameras to film it. So they take their leader and Zaidan to an area away from their camp. The Baloch uprising against Pakistan's government has received little attention worldwide. Most eyes have been turned toward the fight against the Taliban and Al-Qaeda in other areas of Pakistan. But the Baloch people have never accepted being part of this country. Many of them demand greater control over Balochistan's natural resources and mineral riches. And these fighters who met with Al Jazeera demand outright secession from Pakistan.
Our goal is to free Baloch people. Punjabi tasallut se chutkara hasil karna hai aur baloch qoum ke liye ek khushhal zindagi hai jisme aman insaaf aur barabari ho hum uske liye jadoojahd kar rahe hain sawal ye paida hota hai pakistani kaun hai pakistani qoum hai pakistani to qoum nahi hai yahan sindhi hai baloch hai pashtun hai punjabi hai ye sare aqwam hai pakistani to koi qoum nahi hai ab hame zabardasti kyun koi pakistani bana rahe aur bana ke hamare wasail ko lootna chahta hai تو یہاں ہم اس کے اداروں کے خلاف لڑ رہے ہیں جتنے بھی اس کے انتظامی ادارے ہیں چاہے پولیس ہے کوئی اور ادارے ہیں جو اس لوٹ مار میں اس کو تقویت دے رہے ہیں جو اس کی طاقت کو بڑھا رہے ہیں ہم ان کو کمزور کر رہے ہیں
Obsessed with secrecy, like most guerrilla movements, the Baloch insurgents fight in separate, independent groups with elusive leaders whom very few can identify. Baloch Khan tells Al Jazeera that it is this secrecy and lack of a command structure that will make sure that the Baloch insurgents are not easily defeated.
शायद नहीं चाहते इसलिए कि तामिल टाइगर्स का आप लोगों के सामने है कि एक बिल्कुल वो उन्होंने एक मुनज़्ज़म फौज बनाई जिनका यूनिफॉर्म था और एक खत्ते में उनका आई कमान भी आके जाहिर हुआ करते करते कुछ सालों में उन्होंने शिकस्त देखा कुछ ऐसे वजूहत हैं इसी वजह से हो सकता है आगे जाके जब ज़रूरत महसूस होगा हम एक होंगे एक यूनाइटेड क्यों हम एक कौम है हम इस कौम की आज़ादी के लिए लड़ रहे हैं
Baloch fighters say that it is this burning desire to free their land from Pakistan that sustains them in this harsh environment. But as they fight for separation, they blame the Pakistani army for instigating the conflict in the first place.
Aur ye jang hamare haathon se zyada Punjabi ke haath mein, Punjabi army ke haath mein ki wo usko kis taraf le jana chahta hai. Wo zyada Baloch pe pressure dalega, wo zyada dabane ki koshish karega, hum zyada ubrenge. Wo zyada berehmi karega, wo auraton bachchon ko marega, phir hame bhi majbooran wo kadam uthana padega. Wo beguna Balochon ko maar raha hai, phir hum bhi majboor honge. कहीं ना कहीं जाके हम भी मजबूर होंगे सिर्फ और सिर्फ उसको सिखाने के लिए उसको सबक देने के लिए हो सकता है अगर वो कल खला को बहुत ज्यादा बमबारी करेगा हमारे आम लोगों पे जो पहले भी किया उसने शायद इस वक्त तक हम सब्र से काम कर हो सकता है कि हमारा टारगेट इस्लामाबाद भी हो हमारा टारगेट लाहौर भी हो हमारा टारगेट पिंडी भी हो उसमें तो कोई शक नहीं मगर अब हम समझते हैं अब भी है वो हालत हो सकता है कि हम कुछ वक्त और उनको देखना चाहते हैं
Baluch Khan's ancestors, the Baluch people, traced their roots to ancient tribes from around the city of Aleppo in Syria. They believe these tribes migrated to this region in pre-Christian times. Over the centuries, they say, this rugged landscape sheltered them from numerous invading armies and helped the Baluch people maintain their independence.
I think Balochistan is best understood as a no man's land, nobody really cared about, as a very mountainous and desert-like area, which was largely irrelevant throughout history. For that reason, Balochistan served very well the purpose of being a refuge area for people who could not be accommodated in the Indian or Iranian empires, who moved to today's area to Balochistan, taking refuge and carving out some space for themselves. According to Baloch perception, the Baloch see themselves as people of Arab origin. Some Baloch scholars even see the Baloch as conquerors moving eastward, always in search of freedom and self-determination.
Kalat, the historic capital of Balochistan. 6 decades have passed since it was annexed by Pakistan, one of that country's first acts as a newly formed state. Al Jazeera met with Emir Muhyiddin, a prince of the royal family that ruled Balochistan at the time that Pakistan took over. Muhyiddin says that the only reason Baloch leaders chose to join the new country was a sense of religious obligation. Both sides were Muslim.
Because of the backing of the British, and they gave a lot of trouble.
Kalat, which represented most of what is Balochistan today and Baloch areas, they were given the choice to either become independent or become part of Pakistan. The both houses of common and the house of upper and lower houses, they voted for independence. Whereas my father, having influence of Islamic and at that time, of the thought that an Islamic Republic is being made in Pakistan, he had his preferences that we should have an understanding with Pakistan and then join Pakistan. So during this interim period, force was used, army action in April 1948 was used. You see, Pakistan became independent in August 1947. Balochistan joins Pakistan in April 1948. For this 9-month period, Balochistan was independent. Kalat was independent. Then by force, the instrument of accession was signed and Pakistan took over the state of Kalat.
Balochistan was forcefully occupied, annexed by the Pakistan forces. It wasn't part of Pakistan in 1948. So Pakistani army rolled in Balochistan. Somehow under duress, and the Khan of Kalat, who was the head of Balochistan, had to sign an accession treaty. So that was the main reason we all still do not recognize Balochistan as part of Pakistan, and we think it's an occupied territory.
Over the last six decades, the Baloch rebellion and Pakistan's suppression of it has claimed thousands of lives. Among the dead are many key leaders of the insurgency. One of the most prominent leaders killed was this man, Nawab Akbar Khan Bugti, a former minister in the government of Pakistan and a leader of the important Bugti tribe. At 80 years of age, he led the rebellion when General Pervez Musharraf was president. Musharraf attempted to negotiate with Bugti.
We found Nawab Akbar Khan Bugti very reasonable, amenable to compromise, willing to discuss, willing to listen, and willing to settle. But unfortunately, there is a mindset in Pakistan, in the Pakistani establishment, in the Pakistani civil and military bureaucracy, and I would even say among certain Pakistani politicians, that mindset is unwilling to concede the legitimate rights of the smaller provinces like Balochistan. And I remember a famous conversation with General Musharraf when we were about to clinch the settlement. There were some impediments. And he said, how can we trust Bugti? How can we believe his intentions? I said, it's not a question of intentions. It's a question of getting the thing done.
When negotiations failed, the Pakistani army attacked Akbar Bugti's home village in December 2005. 8 months later, he was killed in a mountain hideout, along with 32 of his tribesmen.
Apparently, Pervez Musharraf proved it, that he does not have a single decent bone in his body. And what they did, we don't even know where my father is buried. We don't believe that all the drama that they brought that box and buried it in Dera Bugti and put locks on it. Who puts locks on caskets and all that? Nowhere in the world, but in this country, you do all these stupid things and you expect the people to praise and to say, oh, we are the well-wishers of Pakistan. How can you expect any Baloch to be a well-wisher when you treat the Baloch like this, or our elders like this?
Bugti's death further fueled the Baloch rebellion. The fighting moved to the streets of Balochistan's cities and towns. Angry protesters targeted the symbols of Pakistan.
See, that's where this is where the establishment miscalculated. They thought that once we get rid of Akbar Bukti, everything will die out, not realizing that it will spread to each and every corner of Baloch land. Today, the movement which my father started has spread to each and every corner of the Baloch land in Balochistan. So you can see the rebellion from in 1948 and 58 and then 70s and now. So it's the process always been there. And like I said, everybody, every nation wants to be free. And if the Baloch wants to be free, there is nothing wrong with that.
Baloch leaders, however enraged, were also afraid for their lives. Following the killing of Akbar Bukti, they gathered in Kalat, the former Baloch capital, to reevaluate the insurgency. Such a traditional gathering of leaders and elders, also known as a jirga, had not taken place in Balochistan for over a century.
I called a jirga after 137 years. My great-grandfather, Amir Khudaidad Khan, called a jirga. And then I called a jirga, in which 99% or let's say 98% of the Baloch participated. All the tribes participated, whether it was political parties, all political parties also participated.
There was a jirga here. All the sardars, all the political parties, they were here, and they all declared that we want our position which was before 1948. It was semi-independent. I don't say that even during the British we were absolute independent, but they were semi-independent. Few narrow-minded bureaucrats sitting in Islamabad, you see, with the mentality of a colonialist, they still overrule everything. They haven't learned a lesson from Bangladesh. Bangladesh became independent. Bangladesh, they lost opportunities, and then they recognized Bangladesh themselves.
The Baloch are a staunchly tribal people. Each of the 18 major tribes is headed by a sardar or chieftain, and each sardar commands his own well-armed militia. The Mengals are one of the largest Baloch tribes, and its chieftain is Sardar Ataullah. Al Jazeera's Ahmed Zaidan met Ataullah in his stronghold. He refused to speak on camera, but stressed that he adamantly opposed any compromise with the Pakistani government. A few weeks after Al Jazeera met with Ataullah, Pakistan's Prime Minister, Yusuf Raza Gilani, paid him a visit to persuade him to reconcile. But the Sardar was unmoved. In the push and pull between Pakistan's government and Balochistan's rebellious chieftains, the lives of ordinary Baloch people are at a standstill. Despite being Pakistan's largest province, Balochistan suffers from the lowest health, education, and living standards in the country. The answer to the question of who is to blame for this chronic underdevelopment depends on who you ask.
People say that we don't have agriculture because there's no electricity. They come and blow up the pipelines. They come and blow up the electric power lines, the pylons. They come and blow up the gas installation. They want to blow up the gas. They want to come and blow up the railway track. And they want to come and try to hijack an aircraft. They make an attempt and kill the settlers. They want to come and destroy the schools. They want to come and kill the teachers. And any foreign investor who comes in. Now what are they doing? Are they helping any Baloch cause? I would like to say they are the biggest bloody hurdle in the way of getting the Baloch cause. So what they're doing, they're exploiting the right reasons for wrong ends.
Basically, Sardar are elected by the people historically. They should not serve Pakistan, they should serve the people of Balochistan.
The federal government is fully responsible, not the Sardar. Because the Sardar, they were not having this authority to build school, to build colleges, to build hospital. The federal government from 1947 yet till now, they have not paid attention to this area.
What about all those Sardars who are not anti-development? I have not seen any development in their areas. Let's go start from Karachi. We go to Las Bela, Jam's area. Jam has been pro-establishment since day one. Let's go to the Jamalis. They have always been in government. Let's go to the Maksis. Let's go to Zairis. Let's go, you name it. Except for three, Mari, Bukti, Mangal, these three bad Sardars. What about all the good Sardars? Show me one college, show me one clinic, show me one hospital, show me one library, show me one school where they will send their own children.
Balochistan, Pakistan's least developed province, sits on untold amounts of wealth. Hundreds of millions of dollars worth of oil and mineral reserves. At the University of Balochistan, Dr. Abdul Salam has studied these natural resources for years.
Really, our province of Balochistan is very rich in a variety of minerals like iron ore deposit, like copper deposit, like chromite deposit, like oil and gas and zinc. The whole Balochistan is really full of these mineral resources. Iron ore is very abundant in Dilband area, in Chagi area. More than 200 million ton iron is present in the Dilband area. More than 70 million ton iron is present in the Chagi area. Similarly, copper is quite in a huge amount is present in the Chagi area, like Sandak, like in the Kodik area. And it's as chromite in Muslimbagh area is present in a huge quantity. Just we need to explore these things to exploit these things. And lead zinc is present in Las Bela area. Oil and gas, in the Adera Bukti area, in the north Balochistan, it's quite common. These are quite huge resources for Balochistan. Gold is common. They are associated with the copper. They are present in Chagi area, in the Rikodik area, in the Sandak area.
Bawajood iske ke is sarzamin mein Baloch sarzamin mein koila, گیس پٹرول سنگ مرمر بہت سے ایسے قیمتی وسائل ہیں جو عام بلوچ کے خوشحال زندگی کے لیے بہت ہی زیادہ ہیں مگر اس سے دوسرے استفادہ کر رہے ہیں دوسرے فائدہ اٹھا رہے ہیں
آغاز حقوق بلوچستان سے اس صوبے میں سماجی اور اقتصادی ترقی کے ایک ایسے دور کا آغاز ہوگا جس میں استحصال نہیں بلکہ انصاف ہوگا۔ دہشت گردی نہیں بلکہ امن اور تحفظ ہوگا، جہالت کا اندھیرا نہیں بلکہ علم کی روشنی ہوگی، مایوسی نہیں بلکہ اعتماد ہوگا۔ میں نہایت خلوص دل کے ساتھ آپ تمام کی طرف سے اس خواہش کا اظہار کر رہا ہوں کہ ہم ان تمام سیاسی قوتوں کو ساتھ کے ساتھ بات چیت کرنا چاہتے ہیں۔ ہم اس معزز ایوان کے توسط سے ان کو بات چیت کی دعوت دیتے ہیں۔
After decades of fighting, the chieftains and the people of Balochistan were in no mood for dialogue. They had heard the Pakistani government's words of reconciliation before and felt that nothing had ever come of them. In 2010, the Pakistani government launched the Balochistan Rights Package, a program that promised schools, hospitals, roads, jobs, and financial support for the province. But on the streets of Balochistan, its people rejected the program, and the Baloch chieftains scoffed at the offer and refused to accept what they called the government's charity.
This is a sort of a zakat that has been given for the Baloch. And most of the people who are sitting in the government, maybe it suits them to do some corruption. But as far as the Baloch is concerned, they don't want any zakat. They don't want charity.
So provincial autonomy, development, these are, as one of your generals once said, peanuts for us. Slavery or high wages is not the substitute of independence. Suggesting to simpler people that we are ready to talk, whereas they're not. Concentration or armed struggle should be diverted to elsewhere. People giving up, people hoping, expecting.
This is the port of the city of Gwadar in southwestern Balochistan. Sitting on the Arabian Sea, it's a place that went from a fishing village to a full-fledged port city within the last decade. Gwadar is the place from where Pakistan plans to announce itself as an international shipping hub and a conduit for oil and energy for the rest of the region. Small wonder then that the country's government is vigilant about security here.
There's a healthy competition between Bandar Abbas and Gwadar and Karachi, Bin Qasim and Chabar. So why not? Business is healthy competition. You see, now it depends on us that we should bring peace, we should give security to the businessmen, and we should make this port a more viable, more marketable port than the others. You see, we should get into a competition. So if we start thinking that there would be an unhealthy competition, no, I don't believe in that.
But to the Baloch people, Gwadar and its development are reminiscent of a mindset dating back to the British colonization of this region, one that built roads and railways to serve its armies.
These are destructive, as I understand it. This is to sort of occupy you, bring in outside population, and exploit your resources.
The people who are opposing these kind of activities, they are in a very small number. But their voice can be heard everywhere. Majority of the people they want development and progress.
While that may be true, the people of Balochistan don't necessarily want that development and progress to come from the Pakistani government, who they say can't be trusted. That sentiment was clear during a recent visit to Gwadar by the Pakistani Prime Minister, as he held a cabinet session in the city to launch work at the port. Residents from the area staged protests condemning the government and its plans for that port.
آئیے وزیر اعلیٰ گشت کی چلے عرب کے مراکش رستگا ہمیں سرمچا رانی برکتا رستگا تو میری واجہ وطی چھکا وطی زاگا منگوشا کیسے مرچی مات پہ تو تی چھکا منگوشا کہ کاؤ کی بروے گاؤ کی برے اور راؤ کی بروے بلکہ وطی زاگا کہ ایروین کشتگا سماتا نسرا کپتگا ہاں بگوشا بروے کوہ دنگ بکنا پا پلو سے ننگا
This is a region that has seen decades of poverty and negligence. And people here feel that their needs can hardly be addressed by a prime ministerial visit or building a port.
Port jab bana to yahan kaam bhi shuru hua ikka dikka kaam shuru ho gaya tha to naam tha Gwadar ke bandon ka ke Gwadar ke bandon ke kaam lagayenge kaam pe lagayenge मगर गवादर के बंदे अभी बेरोजगार हैं हम मैंने तो पढ़ा नहीं है मगर यहाँ पढ़े लिखे भी हैं किसी ने एपे किया है बीए किए हैं वो बेचारा बेरोजगार हैं यहाँ के जो बंदे सब मचे रहे हैं उन लोगों ने रात दिन रात मेहनत किया अपने बच्चों के लिए अपने बच्चों को पढ़ाया है और पढ़ा लिखाया है किस लिए
While local residents here are concerned about their basic survival, local politicians are also worried. What's happening in Gwadar cuts to the heart of their political future. They fear the influx of outsiders into the area and the demographic change that will bring about.
You are going to build the mega projects like Gwadar, and you are trying to make a big Karachi again in Balochistan. There is a problem with the Baloch because they have a big land with small population. We have only one guarantee which are asking from this federation that the demographic change of the Baloch is a major danger for the Baloch people.
And my priority is to first to give employment to the locals, people who belong to this land, who are indigenous. This land, and if we don't find people of special skills, if they're not available here, so it is but natural that we can get them from other places. You see, because we have to get the work going, and if the in the local population we don't get a person with a particular skill, so I would never allow that work or that project to be. Stopped over there. No, I would find. But this should be very clear. I've spoken to the Prime Minister, to the high ups in Islamabad, that people who would come from abroad, come from other places in Pakistan, they may buy property, they may indulge in trade and commerce activities, but we will never allow outsiders to vote here. Is the right to vote? No, not at all. And you know, I'm very clear about that.
It It's also very clear that what's happening in Gwadar is bigger than Balochistan and its people. This port has international significance. And what the Baloch people and their politicians have to say about it matters little.
There are two competing concepts. One is the American, who want to block the Chinese and the Russians and the mainland coming to the south, and the other, China, Pakistan, and this landmass of Southwest China, West Asia, East Asia. We want the area to be open to all of them. There is conflict. And I'm sure that Americans, despite all their efforts, they cannot succeed in blocking. They cannot succeed in putting a check on this breakout into the south, to the south, to the warm waters of Arabian Sea, because they stand defeated in Afghanistan. And that is the problem at the moment, how they can manage their interests and yet they retreat from Afghanistan. This is the dilemma that they are facing today.
All the oil flow, which goes from whether Saudi Arabia, from Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, or from Abu Dhabi, or from Iran, and Iraq, this all goes through. This is a sort of a strategic hub, and if you are overlooking the hub and you have control over it, then you can control the economies of the world by regulating the flow of the oil. So this is a great game, you can say.
As Al Jazeera's Ahmed Zaidan makes his way back to the Baloch capital, Quetta, there's an overnight suicide attack targeting Pakistani paramilitaries in the area. More and more, such attacks are becoming a common occurrence, and there is a promise of more bloodshed to come.
How much of our people are being killed? Our killing is terrorism, their killing is target killing by us. Same coin, different meanings. Baloch kills, target killing. Terrible, inhuman. And they kill for the sake of humanity, culture, justice, so on and so forth.
ہم صرف یہ کہنا چاہتے ہیں کہ بلوچ اس وقت حالت جنگ میں بلوچ پہ ہر گزرنے والے دن بہت زیادہ ظلم ہو رہا ہے یہاں پہ آرمی خفیہ ایجنسی ہیں ہمارے نوجوانوں کو اغوا کر رہے ہیں جو دو دو تین تین سال سے جن کا کوئی اتا پتہ نہیں بلوچ حالت جنگ میں ہے اور بلوچ یہ چاہتا ہے کہ جب تک ہم اپنی سرزمین پہ با اختیار نہ ہو ہمارے وسائل ہماری سرزمین ہمارے اختیار میں ہو کوئی ہم سے کوئی بھی توقع نہ رکھے بلوچ کا گھر جل رہا ہے اور کوئی آ کے بیٹھ جائے کہے کہ جی میں یہاں پہ امن کی وہ گیت سنوں گا یا امن کے جو ہے قصے سنوں گا یہ شاید اس کی بے وقوفی ہے
Pakistan's paramilitary forces have been relentless in their crackdown on rebels in this area for years. The Pakistani army has even built new military barracks here from where they launched their operations. But in most cases, the victims of these operations are civilians. As their body count rises, chances of an end to the attacks and counterattacks seem bleak.
ایف سی کو میں کہوں کہ وہ بلوچوں کے قاتل ہیں تو یہ زیادہ بہتر رہے گا
آج جو یہاں پہ جو ظلم و ستم پی ایف سی کر رہی ہے اس کی مثال کہیں نہیں ملے گی آپ کو. یہاں تک کہ یہی ایف سی تھی جنہوں نے مطلب ہمارے جو بالکل غریب لوگ ہیں ان کو پکڑ کے ان کے مال مویشی لوٹ لیے, ان کو جلایا گیا, ان کو جلتے ہوئے کھولتے ہوئے ڈرموں میں ڈامبر کے ڈرموں میں تارکول کے ڈرموں میں ان کو ڈالا گیا.
فرنٹیئر کو بلوچستان ہیز لاسٹ اباؤٹ 160 پیپل ان دا وے آف ڈیوٹی, دے ہیو لاسٹ دیئر لائف. ٹو ہیو امبریسڈ شہادت لاسٹ ایوننگ, یو مسٹ ہیو ہرڈ اباؤٹ اٹ. مور دین 300 ہیو لاسٹ دیئر لمبس اینڈ اسٹل وی آر دیئر ٹو سپورٹ آر پیپل ہو آر انوسنٹ. They are only very limited class of the terrorists, and we will make sure that over our dead bodies we will not let them radiate and spread more terror. Yes, we will have to sacrifice our life. So that is why they find FC to be standing like a tall wall.
But the army's failure to effectively deal with Baloch guerrilla fighters makes Islamabad see a link between the Indian presence in Afghanistan and the disorder in Balochistan.
Certainly, if there is an increase of Indian interference in Afghanistan, it is a matter of concern for Pakistan.
Is there interference of Indian in Balochistan issues and troubles?
I've already raised up with Dr. Manmohan Singh, the Prime Minister of India.
After the arrival of America once again, Indians came riding on their back, so they are taking actually what is called a free ride on the American shoulders, and they came into Afghanistan and they started spreading their tentacles, and they are up to their old games. So behind this entire turmoil that one sees in Balochistan,
well, there was a thinking in the United States that they wanted to separate Balochistan from Pakistan, so that in case Pakistan does not play the game with them, they could make use of the Balochistan territory as a separate independent state. And this was also the purpose of the Indians. So Indians and the Americans, they did collaborate, and all the conspiracy which had been going on from Afghanistan in particular and from other areas by American agencies, it was with that purpose, that they wanted to create an alternative, an independent Balochistan.
Baloch leaders, though, reject that they have any Indian support. However, they say that if India did want to help, it would be welcomed.
Even a swine wants to help us. India is human, Hindus. What is strange about India for us Baloch, what is not for Punjabis, Americans or English? Is India such a demon? India wants to help us, we deny, because what we are? We are true Muslims. We are true Pakistanis, neither applies. We are Muslims for our own sake, and we are more Baloch than Pakistani.
Back in the capital of Quetta, yet another protest. This time by Baloch women. They've taken to the streets demanding to know the whereabouts of their husbands and sons who have disappeared. Hundreds of young Baloch nationalists and activists have been picked up by Pakistani security over the last decade. Many of them were later found dead, their bodies showing signs of severe torture. For the families of the missing, such street protests have become an everyday activity.
کچھ ایسے ایریاز بھی ہے ان کا اپروچ میڈیا تک نہیں ہے ان کو میڈیا تک رسید نہیں ہے اس وجہ سے یہ مشکلات ہو رہے ہیں تو دوسری جو اس حوالے سے جو ہم لوگوں نے 1100 کا فگر کمپلیٹلی مکمل کیا ہے 3 مہینے کے اندر وہ بھی ہم نے اپنی مدد آپ کے تحت کیا ہے مشکلات بھی زیادہ ہے وسائل بھی ہمارے پاس ہمارے تنظیم کے پاس اتنے نہیں ہیں تو اس سے معلوم ہوتا ہے کہ ان آپریشن کے دوران ہزاروں لوگوں کو اٹھایا گیا ہے بلوچستان سے
مسنگ پیپل از اندر کنٹروورسی لیٹ می ٹیل یو اسٹارٹنگ فرام 12,000 to 13,000 پیپل 3 to 4 years بیک دے ہیو کم ڈاؤن ٹو اونلی فیو ہنڈریڈ لیٹس اے لٹل اوور 200 Either that demand was wrong or people have come back. If they have come back, has anybody said?
In an area where international, regional, and local interests converge, there is every reason to believe that Pakistan's Baloch rebellion is only heading towards greater confrontation, greater suppression, and a constantly rising death toll. And if there is a ray of hope for the people of this region, it is at best very faint.